All right, now we're moving on to the seventh tablet. Now, starting about here with the seventh tablet, and especially tablets 8 and 9, the style, the literary style, starts to change quite drastically. Now, the reason why, I'm sure some of you have already guessed this, why there's no punctuation is because this is meant to evoke a primordial time before such civilized things as punctuation existed. And so far as I know, the Sumerians did not have punctuation in their tablets. At least not to my knowledge. So that's the reason why there's no punctuation. Okay. And it was that An and Enlil and Ea and Shamash met together, and An decreed that a debt must be paid, that the killing of Humbaba and the Bull of Heaven required blood, and that one of the two must die. And Enlil nominated Enkidu, to the consternation of Shamash, who accused him of manipulating them into their deeds. And Enlil then accused Shamash of playing favorites. But the decree of Enlil had been decided, and it was ratified by An, and the matter was settled. And now, days later, here it was. Enkidu, liquefying skin soft waxen with pustules, eyes yellow, rotten pieces of fruit, bones inside of his skin brittle and cracking as he turned over in bed. The exorcist Lusagata, meanwhile, had drawn a circle of black flour around his bed and was presently holding a tamarisk branch in one hand and pronouncing a liturgy of demonic expulsion. The illness, he said, that has cocooned this man has come from the netherworld. A demon has taken hold and now hangs him upside down. His body is possessed by a Saku. His arms and legs are paralyzed, chest worn and ragged with coughing. His mouth is full of phlegm. Behold this man, dumb, cast down and prostrate. He sprinkled some flour upon Enkidu's body and continued, Azalui, you have seen Enkidu in this wretched state, and you have gone to your father Enki and said to him, I do not know what this man could have done to be thus afflicted, but you, Father, know everything, so tell me how I may heal him. May the divine healer Gula, who is able to restore the dying to life, make him whole again by the touch of her hand, and you, Azalui, utter the formula that will free him from bondage. Now, this is a real exorcism formula. I did not make that up. As also previously in the book, the prayers, the one uttered by Gilgamesh to the dead, and the one uttered by his mother, those are all real invocations and prayers. I did not make those up. Lusagata put a necklace of stones around Enkidu's neck, lapis lazuli, gold serpentine breccia. The necklace will protect him from wandering spirits who have been cast out of the netherworld. Gilgamesh nodded, and the exorcist finished and left, and Gilgamesh found himself alone in the small, quiet room, alone with the sound of his dying friend's labored breathing, sitting on the baked brick floor beside his matted, rumpled, sweat-soaked bed, with his friend two clay lamps burning sesame oil cast enormous jittering pools of nervous orange light upon the ceiling, and outside the full moon, which the exorcist had chosen for his rite, was incandescent through the window, burning red and furious, a harvest moon, or a moon of some terrible kind of eclipse. My friend, Enkidu said, it is already too late for all of this. I dreamed last night that I was standing before the great Anzu bird, and that he was roaring at me and flapping his wings. And as his great clawed bat-like wings feathered the hair, the air, the wind, what they stirred carried dead human souls that it let loose into the heavens. And I was blown backwards and found myself falling endlessly into an ancient blue darkness with mottled green cliffs and serrated yellow edges in a darkness that was so deep and fathomless that no night could ever touch it or come near it. And then I was traveling down a road through a gray, narrow canyon, and came to the vast bronze-green gate of Ganzir, where a man with two faces, who was holding a torch that kept back a small circle of the ancient darkness, took away all my clothes, and then shoved open the gate, and I followed him through into a black chasm where creatures of all kinds, some with long tails, some with lion's paws, and some with scaly green lizard legs, scattered in all directions, fleeing from the light of the torch as it approached them, burning a small gold coin in a vast gray, blue, purple darkness, my friend. And the man with two faces led me down into a canyon where there was no light anywhere, save from his torch. But I could see an enormous black tree with bare, naked, knife-like branches cut out from the gloom. And upon this tree I could make out figures, birds hopping from one branch to the next, and they had human heads on them, with empty, white, staring eyes that didn't have pupils, my friend. And the worst part of it was that they kept trying to speak out words as if they were choking, but they couldn't get the words out because They couldn't remember who they were, my friend. All of their memories were gone. And we kept walking along the narrow dirt road that kept leading us further and further downward. And there was another canyon up ahead. And we came to the rim and looked out into a wilderness of barren rocky waste. And I could see lion centaurs, men with the bodies of lions. And they were human from the waist up. And they were crawling around, picking up stones and boulders and making huge megalithic piles out of them, as though they were trying to build ancient Stone Age monuments. But on the other side of the piles, there were bullmen, centaurs, who were taking the stones away. So that as the pile grew, it shrank at the same time, and it seemed that the labors of the lion centaurs were being wasted. And then we came to another vast ebony plain with very little light. It seemed like the only light came from glowing rocks, like volcanic magmatic rocks that were cooling off and yet still glowing inside with their internal red-orange heat. And on this plain were scattered human figures, but they weren't doing anything. They were just sitting there with their knees drawn up, each person by himself, scattered across the plain. And then there came the sound of a wailing, as of a dirge, and a wash of bright yellow light. And I looked up to see the sun god come burning his way through. And as he passed by us overhead with gold radiance, the people came to life and began each one to walk in a little circle until the sun was gone and disappeared into the purple darkness as a tiny dim point. And then all the people sat down again and made no movements at all. They only lived for that little bit of light that Shamash gave them at the end of each of his days. And the man with two faces kept going, and in the light of his torch I beheld a crowd of people walking in a single huge circle around a broken, jagged stone. And one of them saw me and came over to me and said that he was a Tana. And he told me of his journey on the back of an eagle to the heavens, and I marveled at his tale. And then he disappeared back into the crowd. And another man came over to me and said that he was Adapa, the first man, the one who had been offered by Anu the food of immortal life, but he had been warned by Enki not to take it or he would die. And so he missed his chance at immortality and brought death to all men in the world. And then he too disappeared with all the walking people. And then another man, Gilgamesh, came over to me and he said that he was your father, Lugobanda. And he said to tell you that he had been poisoned and that a Baru priest had stolen his jawbone for divination purposes and to beware of him. And then he disappeared back into the swirling crowd too. And then we continued walking along the road, and suddenly I beheld an Asaku demon step from out of the darkness into our path, a fiery red lion demon with wings that walked on its hind legs and crossed its arms before it in the shape of a massive clawed X. And it looked at me with dark burning eyes that were like two pieces of magma taken from the depths of the earth and placed into its skull, and it was terrifying to behold, my friend, this Asaku demon. The demon of illness that I knew had me in its grip as I was sleeping, dreaming this dream. And then it continued walking on its way, and I watched as it disappeared a flaming beacon into the charcoal depths of Irkala. And then I beheld yet another demon, a man who had enslaved a Mashishu serpent, a giant creature with seven serpent heads that walked on all fours. And a man was riding its back as though it were a horse. And he kept whipping it as the blue glowing creature went past us in the night. And I wondered what monstrosity or color would produce next, for the Mashishu serpent is a plague demon who destroys entire cities. And I wondered where he might be headed, what city it might be planning to destroy. And then we were moving again, and the road went down into a steep ravine that led to a large bowl-shaped depression of red glowing rocks where the throne of Ereshkigal was. And I saw her, my friend. She was beautiful to behold, wearing a scarlet dress, with her right shoulder covered, the opposite of the way it is in your city world, Gilgamesh, where everyone covers their left shoulder to hide the shame of the left side of the body. And her scribe Geshtanana sat by her side with a green clay tablet, and she was reading a list of names from it. But when she saw me, she looked up and said, "Who is this man who brings him here, and what is his name?" And I was about to speak to tell her that my name was Enkidu, but I couldn't remember it, Gilgamesh. I couldn't even remember my name. And I began to realize it was just the beginning of the process of forgetting, that it would begin with the forgetting of the name, and then the walking in circles with all the other dead rehearsing the deeds that brought you to Irkala, and then the slow transformation, the growing of feathers, and the building of piles of stones to keep you occupied, and then the state of torpor and inactivity, where the only pleasure you would ever have was the brief moment of the sun god's passage of light and luminosity, and eventually to become one of the birds with human heads hopping from tree to tree who could no longer remember who they ever had been or who they had ever known. And that was the vision that Enkidu unfolded to his friend Gilgamesh as he lay dying upon his deathbed. And after recounting it, Gilgamesh said, "My friend, you saw a vision that will never be equaled." And the slight trace of a faded smile momentarily ghosted across Enkidu's face as he said, "My friend, promise me you will never forget me." And he grabbed Gilgamesh with one hand, and then the hand went limp as he expired and left Gilgamesh alone in the small, hot room. And Gilgamesh beseeched his friend not to leave him, but it was too late. His friend had gone and was falling down, sinking like a stone in water to the depths of Irkalla, where he would land on the long road, and the man with two faces would greet him at the gateway to the netherworld and take his clothes from him and raise the torch as he opened the bronze-green gate upon the black enormous chasm. And he went to the tree of the human-headed birds, and then the lion and bull centaurs, and then the plain of the unmoving ones, and those walking in circles, and finally he would come to the throne of Ereshkigal, and her scribe Geshtinanna would ask him his name, and he would just be about to say what it was, and then he would forget it. Eighth Tablet, Day 1. Biotemporal geomorphic X-ray internal anatomical forms. The skeleton of Enkidu is crumbled, disarticulated, and decimated. The blood no longer runs through his veins, arteries, and the rivers inside of him, and the cells that compose the epidermal forest of his skin, lungs, heart, kidneys, and organs no longer luminesce. He is a shell that has been left behind, and all of nature in its internal anatomical X-ray forms weep for him. Not the outer lignin and cells of the trees, cypress, myrtle, and pine, but the internal being there of the treeness beneath all other forms weep for him. Not the outer crystalline forms of the Euphrates and the Olay, but their laminar flows and intensivities weep for him. Their differential morphological chemical internal structures weep for him. The shadow wolf and the creotic lion and the biotemporal hyena and the geomorphic skeletons of the panther, cheetah, stag, jackal, deer, ibex, and dove weep for him. Forms that underlay the surface of the outer shells weep for Enkidu. The plowman and the shepherd, the craftsman and the harlot, internal organs of human habitation in cross-sectional anatomic X-ray biogeo mode, weep for him. It is the inside of nature that weeps for Enkidu, for he is left behind only an outside that Gilgamesh weeps for. There is no longer an inside to Enkidu, for it has gone down to Irkalla to metamorphose into human bird-animal becomings that no longer involved the laminar flow across time, memories, thoughts, acts, feelings stored in memory biotraces of the life of Gilgamesh, for he has become decoupled and delinked with the cross-temporal flow of consciousness that was his friend, and who is no more on the outside with the trees and the wolves and the plowmen and the craftsmen, but has now become pure interiority. Shellless, surfaceless, and without anchor, he is now an absence in the world of semiotic vacancies. Day 2. Gilgamesh summoned the craftsmen, the smith, the lapidary, the coppersmith, the goldsmith, and the jeweler, men who make the outsides of the city's internal organs, and he bade them construct a statue of his friend, but not of the outer shell of Enkidu, but the inner biotemporal geoform of Enkidu, gotten at with the construction of a shell to reach the inward ghost form. Thus was gypsum alabaster from which the statue born, as Enkidu was made of the minerals and clay of the earth, and the eyes and eyebrows of lapis lazuli, because Enkidu had come from the heavens, and the chest of gold, because Enkidu was immortal, and an ivory scepter for the tusks of Umbaba, and bitumen waves of hair for the town of Id, and shell inlay eyes for the necklace of the foundling that Gilgamesh's mother had given him, outer forms to catch the inward being there of what Enkidu had been and always is. Day 3. Abraham bought a cave from the Hittites to bury his wife Sarah, east of Hebron. The Neanderthals, in a cave in Spain, tossed their dead into a pit, a cleft rent into the earth that swallowed the torchlight shuddering down the walls of its maw, that would one day give back the cave of Plato and the Abgrund of Heidegger. But where there are only absences, valences must be inscribed, and if there are no mountains, ziggurats will be built. And if there are no caves, they must be dug. Enkidu was buried in a pit mined into the earth, where they moved the Euphrates with stones and enormous machines and carved out a 10-meter square hole to hell, laid in one corner upon his right side with a red linen kilt and a necklace of lapis carnelian to give the gatekeeper at Ganzir, Ushmu, the man with two faces, bribes for the court below, Inanna for her 3 days' sojourn, a throw stick made of hardwood with a silver weight at one end, Nanasin for his daily journey, the crescent moon god, a boat made of silver, Ereshkigal for the mistress of the great below, a flask of lapis lazuli and a double-bladed axe of electrum, Demutzi for the shepherd husband of Inanna carried away by Galu demons, a flute made of carnelian, Ningishsita for the gatekeeper, dragon in the heavens, a cylinder seal with gold end caps, and for Ninazimua, his bride, the scribe, a silver stylus and tablet of lapis lazuli, surveyor's line, and a golden measuring rod. For Namtar the vizier, and bringer of plagues, a chair made of rosewood, and a staff of lapis lazuli. For Hushbashag, the stewardess of Irkala, a necklace of lapis lazuli. For Kasatabat, sweeper of Ereshkigal, a clasp of silver and a bracelet of carnelian. For Ninshalu Hatuma, cleaner of the house, a relief of the cedar forest made of alabaster inlaid with lapis and carnelian. For Bibu, the butcher of the underworld, a double-edged dagger with a haft of lapis lazuli. And for Demutiapzu, the scapegoat of the underworld, a chair with a back made of alabaster. As they all watched, gathered in a crowd at the edges of the pit, Gilgamesh placed a bowl of honey at its lip, and in another of lapis lazuli, melted butter from a clay jar, offerings to Shamash for safe passage below. And then they began to fill the pit with dirt, as Gilgamesh watched his friend recede into the dark, to become a permanent absence in the world of the living, a semiotic vacancy and gap in the symbolic order, for whom now traces must be sought to fill in the gap, as the men filled in the earth and set up the mud brick mound above it. Ninth Tablet. 1. Wandering, narrow corridors of green-gold rushes, floating islands supporting gigantic reed clumps, lagoons full of strange birds, blue kingfishers, white ibis, pygmy cormorants, pelicans, carmen, flamingos, gray coots, cinnamon-teal mallards with green heads, polished mirror-blue water lacerated with small wind-rippled waves, pale corpses of dead fish floating in the depths of the clear water, dark tangles of squirming green weeds visible. In the distance, a group of white pelicans with amber-colored bills look at him with complete indifference. A pair of eagles, dark brush strokes on a vanilla canvas. Fishermen's village of arched reed mudhif houses and cube-shaped serifs. Dirty gray smoke from village fires. Canoes floating, drifting everywhere. Men and boys inside them, full of piles of reeds the color of absinthe, each canoe twinned by its choppy, ragged image in the water. Dilapidated reed fences lining the yards of the houses, women in black gowns making bread in large conical clay ovens. They press heaps of dough onto the inside walls of the ovens, where the fires heat them to a burnt ashy gray. Water buffalo, chocolate-colored, lounging about the courtyards, chewing reeds, children upon their backs, riding them into the river. Tawny, barking dogs, sparrows twittering on the curved paraboloid arches of the roofs of the huts. Children in canoes poisoning fish with datura. My friend, what brings you to the marshes? I am seeking Utnapishti. And so it went. 2. Pink morning air full of mosquitoes. Coots paddling along the green-blue water. Boats sliding through reed beds, hissing past stands of kasab. Silvery gold corridors, lagoons with satiny surfaces, submerged carcass of a buffalo hide splattered with bird droppings. Air dense with gnats that flit in the gold sun and spiral cortical ovoid clouds. Houses built on artificial islands of layers of reeds and black mud. Dismantled canoes, broken chunks of stone anchors. A man sitting in the yard of his frayed reed house, scraping bitumen from the bottom of an upturned canoe. Parallel rows of smoke-colored dung cakes drying alongside the walls of a house. Chips for the fire inside on the hearth. Enamel surface of the river water, coated with scattered chips of phosphorescent sun. A blue and red kingfisher sailing above the water, a lone flamingo with blood-red spots visible beneath its wings as it passes overhead. Emerald fronds splaying the cobalt sky in a green frame with ashen, dusty trunks. multiple islets with soft, spongy ground and endless iterations of green, yellow, green. A fisherman's world, the reed marshes, gazing out over the water smooth and glassy, an inverted world of palm trees and houses painted onto its surface, and tiny tremors quaking through this mirror world as the water is disturbed by a fish or a turtle. 3. A mud island ringed by buffalo skulls, dusty palm trees shading crooked huts with broken walls of matting, small islands full of kassab and sedges and submerged green lagoons, pale milky men in shabby reed fences, morning light filtering into the empty mudif where Gilgamesh slept as a guest. The interior, ribbed like some giant beast, and spaced at intervals marked by a bloody handprint, with each interval lilac, lavender, pink morning. The light jeweled by tiny cracks in the walls of the mudif. He could hear the reeds of the mudif snapping and cracking all around him with the dawning of the day's heat, clay cups and jars laid neatly into rows beside the hearth. Given a cup of hot milk sweetened with honey breakfast, a grass platter full of ashy wheat cakes dipped into a bowl of date syrup. Barking, snarling dogs everywhere, he wanted to kill them. In the palm branches, groups of pink hoopoes scuttling about, a heron lifted up into the air with the sound of someone shaking out a sheet, a large black crow sitting on a branch, watching the map makers below, where an old man, a woman, and a boy are making reed mats. He watched as the old man split each piece of kassab with a knife, making a little pile of them. The woman took a piece from the pile and pounded along its length with a mortar, then passed the flattened stalks to the boy, who took them and wove them into a herringbone pattern nearby, a pile of finished mats, rolled up corn-yellow logs to be sold in a rook. Now Gilgamesh knew where they came from. 4. And then there was the desert to the east of the marshes, always the desert, littered with red and black stones. He had promised Enkidu that he would mourn him in the garb of a lion, and so he would. He grabbed a spear and his longbow and a handful of dates and some flatbread in his leather satchel and set off back through the palms and the sunken villages to the dry land beyond them. Past a salt lake in the west, and a few miles beyond it, came upon the ruins of an old mud brick wall, half covered by sand. Ancient rock cisterns on mounds must have once hosted villages, but they were gone now, buried beneath the dirt. The palms had disappeared, replaced by buttery yellow acacias at intervals along a rock-strewn dry riverbed. A wind kicked up, blowing thin ghostly arcs of dust across the burnt blue horizon. Alabaster clouds. The desert stretched before him, a rusty sheet of flat copper. He could hear them out there, rumbling, growling. The ground fell away into an orange canyon. But as he stood gazing out over a treeless, shrub-lined ravine, he realized that it was an enormous, long-disused irrigation canal. He could make out the ruined masonry and collapsed foundations of what had once been a bridge. There was a hole in one of the walls of the dried-out canal, and he could just make out the dun-colored body of a sleeping lion. He made his way over the edge and walked crab-like down, dislodging chunks of crumbled mud-brick rubble. A scorpion shot out from under one of these pieces and went skidding down the side of the canal. At the bottom of the ravine, he stood looking around at the enormous, desolate walls and felt dwarfed by an ancient and gigantic civilization. Small, low shrubs and thistle bushes sparsely covered the floor of the ditch he stood peering over the ledge, and watched the sleeping lion. He paused to chew on a date and take a few sips from his water skin, a brown, dusty haze kicked up by the wind drifting about him, sand fog. He removed his longbow from his back and withdrew an arrow, but there was a rumbling growl behind him, and in the distance above him he could just make out another lion walking the edge of the canal. He stood completely still. The beast's insouciance meant that it had not yet noticed him. He decided to use the spear instead and raised it with his right hand, placing his left at an angled sight line, then thrust at the lion's retreating flank, heard the satisfying thump as it sank into the beast's flesh. At once the lion took off running. It tried to bite at the spear, batted away with its paws, but the death fear was already seeping into it. It was doomed, and it went away to die. He heard the growl of the other one just behind him and realized his mistake too late as he collapsed to the ground and felt its jaws begin to close around his head. He plunged his dagger straight up into its torso to open up a gash that dumped its entrails all over him, and he got to his feet, covered in lion mucus, blood, sweat, fear, and anger, and he screamed in the death fury frenzy that killing the lions aroused in him. He flayed it and discarded his kilt and replaced it with the skin of a lion. 5. At night, the stars were fossils of ancient light. In the dawn, he watched a storm over the mountains to the east, bursts of purple heat lightning opening up the anatomy of the storm's insides, dust, sand, debris, and slabs of arcuate, wasted orange light. 6. The Mashu Mountains. Impossibly ancient. Pair of twin brown ragged peaks at desert's edge headed east. The edge of the world, the horizon one continuous flat line where it met the cream-colored hinge of brown earth and blue sky. They saw him coming out of the blasted land, an enormous muscled ox of a man, sun-browned, wearing a lion kilt, long beard full of tiny dead things, a string of wolf's teeth around his neck, a longbow slung across his back and matted hair like a yogi's. They were scorpion men, and they stood on human legs, but their bodies were cracked yellow mottled exoskeletons, and they had long stingers and bulbous black eyes, and human mouths and claws instead of hands. They tried to bar his way from heading any further east, for Gilgamesh had reached the ancient Sun Gate, an enormous cave that opened in between the middle of the Mashu Mountains, but it was past noon and the sun god was nowhere near. "I walk in the path of Shamash," he explained to them, and they told him that no human being had ever attempted such a thing, and he told them that he intended to conquer death. His friend had expired, and it terrified him. Death was the great terror, and he could not live with it, and so he was seeking Utnapishti, the flood survivor, the only immortal human being on the flat disk of the earth, and the only one who would know if anyone ever knew how he could attain immortality and defeat death. He didn't want to end up like Enkidu. And the wind blew Gilgamesh's matted, filthy hair as he spoke and endured the unflinching insect gaze of the black eyes with no pupils that sized him up and were terrifyingly silent in their judgment of him, and their enormous creaking bodies after the pause quietly moved aside, and they let him pass. "May the mountains and hills watch over your going," they said to him as their bodies creaked and clattered and their pincher claws rattled. 7. He headed for the cave, but the yawning abyss of fathomless darkness scared him, and instead he decided to go around it, around the Mashu peaks, and on the other side of them there was a garden of stone trees, lapis lazuli trees, carnelian trees, willows with branches made of gold jasper trees, and onyx trees, and beryl trees, and agate trees, and even obsidian trees, and he said to himself, "So that's where all the jewels of Dilmun come from." But they didn't interest him anymore, and he didn't want anything from the trees, because the trees could not give him what he wanted. They had no power over death, only life, and they were not his concern, so he kept moving, kept walking across the flat, brown, empty, desolate plain that looked as if it was headed nowhere, as if at any moment it were about to dump him out into a vast blue void, and he would feel himself falling off the ground, falling upward, and not knowing where he was falling to, as all direction was vitiated. He kept walking, heading for the lower sea and the gulf that would take him to Dilmun.